Welcome to the Explainer. You know, when it comes to judging an investment, we talk a lot about risk. But what if I told you that not all risk is created equal? Today, we're diving into a really powerful tool that helps you see that difference.
Okay, let's just jump right into this. We're always looking at an investment's return, right? But how do we accurately measure the risk we took to get that return? And maybe even more importantly, what kind of risk should we even be measuring in the first place?
And this brings us to a really crucial distinction between two famous performance metrics. And it all hinges on how they define risk. Okay, so here's the fundamental difference. The super popular Sharpe ratio looks at total risk. It penalizes an investment for any and all volatility, period. But the Treynor ratio comes along and makes this fascinating argument. Why should we get penalized for risks that we can easily diversify away? So it focuses only on the risk that's tied to the entire market. You know, the kind you really can't escape.
So, to isolate just that market-specific risk, the Treynor ratio uses this really powerful concept. It comes from the Capital Asset Pricing Model, or CAPM. And that concept, its secret ingredient, is beta.
So, that brings us to the very core of the Treynor ratio, beta. What exactly is this thing, and how does it actually measure this market risk we're talking about?
Put simply, beta just tells us how much we can expect an investment to move relative to the market's own movements. It's really just a measure of its sensitivity to the market as a whole.
Now, I know the formula might look a little bit intimidating at first. Beta is the covariance of the asset and the market, divided by the variance of the market. But let's not get lost in the math here. In simple terms, covariance just measures how two things tend to move together, while variance measures how much something moves on its own.
Let's break that down even more. Think of it this way. Beta is simply a ratio. The top part of the fraction is asking, how much does my asset move with the market? And the bottom part asks, okay, but how much does the market tend to move on its own anyway? That's really it.
Okay, so we've got a formula, but what does the number it spits out actually tell us? That's what really matters here.
Well, if beta is exactly 1, that means the asset basically mirrors the market's movements. If it's greater than 1, like a lot of tech stocks, it's considered aggressive. It's going to move up more when the market's up, but yeah, it's also going to drop more when the market is down. And a beta of less than 1? That suggests a defensive asset, one that's less volatile than the overall market.
All right, now that we've got a solid handle on beta, we can finally put all the pieces together and see how the Treynor ratio actually works.
So how does it work? It's actually pretty simple. We take the portfolio's excess return, that's just the profit you made above what you'd get from a super safe investment, and we divide it by its beta. And the result tells you, for every single unit of market risk I decided to take on, how much extra return did I actually get for it?
Putting it into practice is actually really straightforward. You just need 3 things: your portfolio's average return, the current risk-free rate, and that all-important beta we just figured out. You plug those into the formula, and boom, you're done.
And interpreting it is so simple. Just like with other performance metrics, a higher value is always better. It means you're getting a greater reward for each unit of market risk that you've accepted.
So, if the Treynor ratio offers this more specific, maybe more sophisticated view of risk for diversified portfolios, why isn't it as popular as the Sharpe ratio? Why do we hear about it all the time?
Well, it really just boils down to 2 things: complexity and consistency. See, calculating beta isn't exactly plug and play. It requires a statistical regression. And here's the really tricky part. Your beta can actually change depending on whether you use daily, weekly, or monthly data. The Sharpe ratio, while maybe less precise, is just simpler, and it gives you 1 consistent number, which is why so many people still prefer it.
So, what's the bottom line here? It's all about choosing the right tool for the job. You should use the Sharpe ratio when you're judging your entire portfolio's performance. But when you want to know if adding a single new stock is a smart move for your already diversified portfolio, well, that's when the Treynor ratio becomes your precision instrument.
And this choice between Sharpe and Treynor really gets to the heart of a key question in finance. Do you prefer a simple tool that gives you a broad but maybe flawed picture? Or do you go for a more complex, precise tool that tells you something very, very specific? The answer really reveals a lot about what kind of investor you truly are.